One of the things I love about VR is that sense of exploring and interacting with a new and different world. The problem is that if I go a little bit too far, I hit up against the bounds of my play space. That's where Locomotion comes in. In case you don't know, VR Locomotion just refers to any form of movement that lets players traverse the virtual world in some way other than moving their head normally. In games that feature it, Locomotion is often the system players interact with the most, so it's important to decide on the right type of movement. The problem is, that's kind of hard to do. VR is a relatively new platform, and trying to balance usability, comfort, and fun can be a struggle, but there are ways to use Locomotion to deliver a truly compelling experience. I'm Anuj Patel, and in this video I'll share 3 key factors that I think go into designing a great VR movement system. But before we talk about those, there's a simpler and easier solution to consider. If the overabundance of wave shooters has shown us anything, it's that stationary experiences can be fun. And it's not just wave shooters either. Beat Saber is a fantastic take on building a rhythm game for VR, and it's completely reliant on one-to-one motion tracking. Objects fly towards you, so you don't need to traverse the world. Plus, a lot of the fun comes from moving your body based on the oncoming objects, meaning Locomotion might even detract from what the game has going on. So ask yourself how crucial the Locomotion is to your game. What utility does it provide? How often is it used? If there isn't a strong need for it, you may want to cut the feature entirely. Another advantage to excluding Locomotion is that it won't disorient players, which is something that can happen with movement systems that include teleportation and snap turning. That makes it better than those methods at circumventing a particular pitfall of VR that I think we've all heard of. It's easy enough to say don't make your players sick, but ensuring that without sacrificing on the player's sense of presence in the virtual world and the pleasing curves of nonlinear motion is a bigger challenge. The Oculus developer documentation on VR best practices identifies quite a few factors contributing to discomfort, but these include things like acceleration of any kind and movement in any direction besides forward. At first glance, these seem really limiting, but just because something can cause discomfort doesn't mean that you should never use it in your game. For one thing, there are ways to mitigate motion sickness, like FOV reduction. For another, not every player is equally susceptible to getting sick. In fact, the Oculus Store rates VR applications by intensity, since there are some players who are less prone to simulation sickness, either naturally or because they've developed a tolerance. It's important to identify where your audience draws the line between pleasure and discomfort, and use that as a filter for your ideas. For example, let's compare 2 games with relatively different audiences. The Lab, which is Valve's onboarding experience for new VR users, and Gorn, a hyper-violent gladiator combat game. The Lab was designed for everyone who tried Steam VR, so it needed a very gentle form of Locomotion. They ended up picking the familiar arc-based teleportation, which can be a little disorienting but doesn't cause sickness. Gorn, on the other hand, is a high-intensity experience for hardcore VR players. It uses a form of in-place Locomotion that maps hand movement to the motion of the player rig, allowing you to press a button and pull yourself through the game world. It's more nauseous than a teleport, but also has more natural mapping and works better for the game in other ways. And those other things definitely matter. You see, simulation sickness isn't the only thing that can turn players away. Every game demands something of the player. What makes VR unique in this regard is its control scheme. Standard non-mobile VR platforms have a 6 degrees of freedom headset and 2 motion controllers, with various forms of finger-based input as well. This is more sensitive than any gamepad or mouse and keyboard setup, but just because you can do a lot with it doesn't mean you should. Complicated input sequences can be awkward and confusing, whereas large, sweeping gestures can exhaust or even injure players who try to do them. And if the player can't use the controls to move in the way they need to, then they won't be able to enjoy the game at all. There are a few different things that contribute to this, like the inherent difficulty of the action, how much time players have to perform it, and how often they have to do it. But going back to our example with the Lab and Gorn, note that the Lab doesn't really use Locomotion as a game mechanic. Longbow and Zortex, the 2 real-time action minigames, are both playable stationary. Teleportation can be a little awkward and disorienting, so it makes sense to avoid it in a time-sensitive context. And since there's plenty of time to execute on it when it needs to be done, teleportation in the lab doesn't put the player under much physical or mental load, perfect for an onboarding experience. On the other hand, Gorn's locomotion system requires large, fast, and frequent hand movements to get around, so it's much more physically demanding. However, it places less of a cognitive load on the player when they have to do it because of the simple and intuitive input gesture. This means that it works quite well during the middle of a fast-paced brawl. Plus, the attacking in Gorn is just as physically demanding, if not more, so it's not like the locomotion would turn people away who could otherwise enjoy the game. And for the players who can handle it, that physicality and sense of control over their movement can be a lot of fun. Which leads me to my next point. All of the things I've mentioned up until now are fine, but games are supposed to be fun and evocative. When you choose to make a VR game, it's because you believe you can use the platform to improve the player's experience in some way. When you include a movement system in your VR game, you should do so with the same thought in mind. Locomotion doesn't just have to be a way to move around between the cool parts. It can be one of the cool parts. It's a tool that you can tweak and tune to enhance your game and make the player feel something that they wouldn't otherwise. Climby is the perfect example of what I mean. It's a platformer for VR enthusiasts, and you can tell. It goes all out with the locomotion, featuring three different modes of movement. Walking, which uses in-place movement similar to Gorn, climbing, which is easy enough in VR, and jumping. That's the one I really admire. To do it, you lift your arms up, pull the triggers, then swing down and release as you do. That might seem like a lot of steps, but it's pretty natural, and it kinda just feels like you're throwing yourself across the level. This mechanic also gives you a lot of control, something that's crucial to platformers. You can take huge leaps or tiny hops, depending on how fast you swing your hands. In fact, it's so expressive that it makes the in-place walking system kind of redundant. More importantly, jumping in this game just feels fantastic. Platformers with a jump button usually have to make a trade-off between the animation principle of anticipation and the perceived responsiveness of the game to player input. Climby's jump gives you both, because the anticipation is a part of the input. Instead of pushing a button to play an exciting animation, you perform the exciting motion yourself. That said, Climby's jump is not for everyone. It requires a fair amount of mobility and physical exertion. Plus, while being in control of it is a mitigating factor, the game is full of non-linear motion that can cause discomfort. Even so, I think the trade-off is worth it. But what if there was a way to avoid the need for a trade-off and instead give every player what they want? It's as simple as it sounds. Players have different needs, so why not get them to select between a few different types of locomotion so that they can decide which one they like best? This method allows games with polarizing default settings to appeal to more players than they could otherwise. And as long as the different movement systems match the core experience, what's the harm in giving the player a choice? Sadly, options don't come without a cost. Every new type of locomotion that you want to support will cost development time, not just because it has to be implemented and polished, but also because it has to be balanced. Let's say you're making a beat-em-up and you want a level to take the same amount of time to complete regardless of the player's choice in locomotion. Including both thumbstick movement and teleportation would be a pretty bad idea. You'd either have to make the walking speed way too fast or go with a pathetic teleportation range. Trying to include both of those common familiar options would make it much harder to reach a fun yet fair balancing point than going with just one. Perhaps more importantly, if the locomotion was tied very closely to the theme of the game, there may not even be a sufficiently different second option that still fits well. For example, there's no real alternative to the hand-over-hand controls used in most climbing games. Anything else would change the core experience, so at best you could let players tweak the specifics of that one type of movement. Options also make things more complicated for the player. The player needs to understand what each option does before they can make their choice. More seasoned players are able to handle that, but it can be overwhelming for novices. There's a reason why the lab forces you to teleport. But even if you come up with some appropriate balanced locomotion settings, you still need to pick a default. And the default matters a lot because it's what players will experience the first time they play. If you put the player off your game with a crappy movement system in the beginning, they might not even look into the settings menu before quitting. So options don't save you from having to solve the problem. In fact, they increase the number of problems you have to solve. That being said, there are some factors that might just help you make the right decision so that you can create a fantastic VR movement system. Remember, don't include locomotion unless you have to. It's entirely possible to make fun games without it. And if you do need locomotion, really think about what you want your player to feel, both in the moment and across the whole game. Then pick something that contributes to that experience as much as possible. Before you go to implement your awesome ideas, ask yourself what physical and mental demands you're making of the player, because they have to be able to meet those demands before they can have any fun. And this last part should go without saying, but don't let it make your target audience sick. Always keep in mind that locomotion is often what players interact with the most. Use that to your advantage. Make it as compelling as you can. VR allows for amazing and unique experiences, and I'd hate to see an innovation with such creative potential stick to the same safe forms of basic interaction.